Hello everyone, this session will be in English, talked by Niladri. He's from India and he's also a visit student to UC Berkeley. And he will bring us probabilistic programming using TensorFlow Probability. Let's welcome him.
Hi, thank you. Hi, I'm Niladri. I'm a final year student studying in India. I'm also working as a researcher at Sister's lab at UC Berkeley. Today I'll be presenting my talk on probabilistic programming using TensorFlow Probability. So before we begin, let's start with the story. A hunter wakes up in the morning, looks out of the window and sees a black swan. The hunter is baffled because this has never happened before. And by the time he reaches for his gun, the black swan has disappeared. So fascinated by his discovery, he runs into town to tell everyone about what he has just seen. When the hunter explains his rare sighting, everyone begins to laugh and questions his sanity. No one believes him. They call him crazy and confused because black swans do not exist. They have never seen before, one villager said. It's impossible, another one exclaimed. The hunter knew no one would believe him until he had proof. So he went to hunt the swan. The hunter went out. He luckily found the swan again, killed it, and brought it back to the village. Now everyone was in shock because black swans are impossible. And this is the black swan paradox. The takeaway is that we cannot rule out our hypothesis because we have never witnessed it before. And this is why Bayesian statistics is so vital these days, rather than frequentism. Now, what do we mean by thinking like a Bayesian? Now think this. You're a skilled programmer, and bugs keep slipping into your code. After a particularly difficult implementation of an algorithm, you decide to test your code on a trivial example. Now that passes. You test the code on a harder problem. It passes once again, and it passes the next, and even the next one, which is even more difficult. You're starting to believe that there may be no bugs in your code. If you think this way, then congrats, you're already thinking like a Bayesian. Bayesian inference is simply updating your beliefs after considering new evidence. A Bayesian can rarely be certain about a result, but he can definitely be very confident. Just like in the example above, we can never be 100% sure that our code is bug-free because, frankly, it doesn't exist. But we can be pretty certain that it will work if we run it on a very large number of cases. Bayesian inference works identically. We update our beliefs about an outcome. Rarely we can be absolutely sure unless we have ruled out all other alternatives. Bayesian inference differs from more traditional statistical inference by preserving uncertainty. Now this is really important. At first, this sounds like a bad statistical technique. I mean, isn't statistics all about deriving certainty from randomness? To reconcile this, we need to think starting like Bayesians. The Bayesian worldview interprets probability as a measure of believability in an event. That is how confident we are in an event occurring. In fact, we will see in a moment that this is the natural interpretation of probability. This will lead us to explainable and interpretable machine learning. Predictive systems being used for law and order are facing a lot of controversy, especially in USA, Europe, and even in Asia. Because if we are trying to predict if someone will commit a murder simply because a neural network said so, that is not done. We have to explain what is the method behind our reasoning and not just rely on black box methods. So a little information about Bayes' theorem. It describes the probability of an event based on prior knowledge of conditions that might be related to that event. For example, if cancer is related to age, then using Bayes' theorem, a person's age can be used more accurately to assess the probability that they have cancer. Now, this is a better method if we didn't know the person's age. So, Bayes' theorem states that the probability of A given B is a conditional probability, the likelihood of event A occurring given that B is true. The probability of B given A is the likelihood of event B occurring given that A is true. P of A, which is our initial belief of A. And P of B is a priori, which is the probability that evidence itself is true. So a little bit about TensorFlow. A TensorFlow is an end-to-end open source platform built by Google for machine learning. It has a great set of tools and libraries which make it easy to write state-of-the-art ML algorithms and makes deployment very easy. And those of you who are concerned with static graphs, and you prefer PyTorch, TensorFlow now has eager execution enabled by default after TensorFlow 2.0. TensorFlow Probability uses TensorFlow behind the scenes to accomplish most of its heavy lifting. This makes TensorFlow really fast, since it allows you to take use of TensorFlow and Keras code, which makes TensorFlow Probability very easy to use and intuitive. And if you just want to try it out for a particular case, it becomes very easy. TensorFlow Probability is an open source Python library built using TensorFlow, which makes it easy to combine deep learning models and probabilistic models. It is great if you are a statistician or a data scientist and you just want R-like capabilities to run out of the box on TPUs and GPUs. If you are a machine learning researcher or practitioner, you can build deep models which capture uncertainty. TensorFlow Probability makes it easy to combine deep learning with probabilistic models on modern hardware. If you just want to try machine learning models which take into account uncertainty, you can do that. So TensorFlow Probability is essentially a collection of TensorFlow symbolic expressions for various probability distributions. Now, TensorFlow Probability gives you a whole suite of tools. Some are around building the model itself, while others are just for drawing inference. Distributions let you model with different probability distributions like normal distribution, uniform, Bernoulli, etc. A bijector is something useful for transforming a random variable. It has mainly three kinds of operations. One is like it has a forward operation, which turns one random outcome into another random outcome from a different distribution. It has something called an inverse, which is used for reversing that transformation to compute one probability in terms of another. It also has layers and losses, which are probabilistic layers that wrap up variational inference with different distributional assumptions. EdWard 2 is a probabilistic programming language which is baked right into TensorFlow Probability. MCMC has a collection of Markov chain Monte Carlo methods and kernels like Metropolis Hastings, Random Walk, and Hamiltonian Monte Carlo. There are also tools for variational inference. And when it comes to optimizers, there are stochastic gradient Langevin dynamics, BFGS, and even variational SGD and more. TFP uses distribution subclasses to represent stochastic random variables. Included in this category are instances of classes like autoregressive, Bernoulli, Poisson, uniform, and exponential. You can draw samples from stochastic variables. Variable is basically stochastic if you know all the values of the variable's parameters and components, and it would still be random. Now, how do you initialize a distribution? So if you want to initialize a stochastic or random variable, it requires very few class-specific parameters that describe distribution shape, such as the location and scale. So for example, if you want to initialize a normal distribution, all you have to do is call tf.normal, tfp.normal, and pass it with mean 2 and standard deviation of 3. And you simply can call sample on it to return a tensor that will behave deterministically from that point on. Initializing a stochastic or random variable requires a few class-specific parameters that describe the distribution's shape, such as the location and and scale. Now some terminologies. Prior distributions measure the likelihood of input values. Prior distribution never depends on an input value. Each prior distribution measures the likelihood of a single input value. Each unknown variable, one that has not been observed directly, needs a corresponding prior. Beliefs about which values can be reasonably determine the prior distribution. Conditional distributions, on the other hand, measure the likelihood of an input value given other input values. Typically, the conditional distributions return the likelihood of observed data given the current guess of parameters in the model. Coming to distribution lambda, it is a special Keras model, Keras layer that uses Python lambda to construct a distribution conditioned on the layer inputs. This layer essentially uses Keras to pass the output of the final layer of the model into the loss function, and for the models that will be discussed, all those layers return distributions. You'll see distribution lambda into action very soon. So let's begin with a simple linear regression model to fit some data. And for this example, we won't take into account uncertainty at all. The inference and prediction sections should be familiar to you if you have used Keras before. But the model construction might look a little different. We make it explicit that we are modeling the labels using a normal distribution with a scale of 1 centered around mean that's dependent on the inputs. The tfp.layers.distributionLambda layer, which we talked about, returns a special instance of tfd.distributions, so we are free to take its mean and plot it in the next slide. So as you can see, we have managed to capture the overall trend of the data with the predicted mean of the distribution over labels. However, we can see that the data has a lot more structure to it. It's more complex. And one thing which is clear is that y gets more variable as x increases. So the model we have written so far cannot capture this detail. So let's try something better. Yeah. So what we have seen is that the variability in y for any particular value of x, and we can treat this variability as being inherent to the problem itself. This means that even if we had an infinite training set, we would still not be able to predict the labels perfectly. A common example of this kind of uncertainty is the outcome of a fair flip coin. No matter how many flips you have seen before in the past, it cannot, or you cannot truly predict what will be the next flip. We will assume that this variability has a known functional relationship to the value of x. Let us model this relationship using the same linear function as we did for the mean of y. Now, in addition to the mean of the label distribution, we also will predict the scale. After training and forming the predictions the same way, we can get more meaningful predictions about the variability of y as a function of x. So as you can see, this is much better. Our model is now less certain about what y should be as x gets larger. This kind of uncertainty is called aleatoric uncertainty. It represents a variation inherent to the underlying process itself. Though we've made progress, aleatoric uncertainty is not the only source of uncertainty. Let us consider one more, which we have ignored so far. It is called epistemic uncertainty, which is also known as systematic uncertainty, and it is due to things one would not know in principle, but it doesn't happen in practice. Now, this may be a result of a measurement which is not accurate enough, or because the model neglects certain effects, or because particular data has been deliberately hidden. The noise in the data means that we cannot be fully certain of these parameters of the linear relationship between x and y. For example, the slope we have found in the previous section seems reasonable. But we don't know for sure, and perhaps a slightly shallower or steeper slope would have been probably better than that. So this kind of uncertainty is called epistemic uncertainty, and unlike aleatoric uncertainty, epistemic uncertainty can be reduced if we have more data. To get a sense of this uncertainty, we shall replace the standard Keras dense layer with TensorFlow Probability's dense variational layer. The dense variational layer uses a variational posterior, QW, over the weights to represent the uncertainty in the values. This layer regularizes QW to be close to the prior distribution PW, which models the uncertainty in the weights before we looked into the data. For QW, we'll use a multivariate normal distribution for the variational posterior with a trainable diagonal covariance matrix centered on a trainable location. For PW, we'll use a standard multivariate normal distribution for the prior with a trainable location and a fixed scale. This might look complex, but using dense variation layer, it becomes a lot simpler. One interesting aspect of the code is that when we make predictions using a model with such a layer, we'll get different answers every time we run it. This is because dense variation essentially defines an ensemble of models. Let us see what this ensemble tells us about the parameters of a model. Now, each line which you see represents a different random draw of the model parameters from the posterior distribution. As you can see, this is there is quite a bit of uncertainty here about the linear relationship. And even if we don't care about the variability of y for any particular value of x, the uncertainty in the slope should give us pause if we are making predictions for x, which is too far from zero. Note that this example is such that we are training both PW and QW. This training corresponds to using empirical Bayes. So we use this method so that we wouldn't need to specify the location of the prior for the slope and intercept parameters, which can be tough to get right if we do not have prior knowledge about the problem. Moreover, if you see the prior is very far from the true values, then the posterior might be unduly affected by this choice. In real life applications, both kinds of uncertainties are present. Uncertainty quantification intends to work toward reducing epistemic uncertainties to aleatoric uncertainties. The quantification for the aleatoric uncertainties can be relatively straightforward to perform depending on the application. Techniques such as Monte Carlo method are frequently used. A probability distribution can be represented by its moments, and for the Gaussian case, it is basically mean and covariance. Now that we looked at aleatoric and epistemic uncertainty in isolation, let us see how we can use both how we can take into account both these uncertainties using TensorFlow Probabilities Layer Composable API. And the only change we have made to the previous model is that we have added an extra output to dense variational layer to also model the scale of the label distribution. As in our previous solution, we get an ensemble of models, but this time they'll also report the variability of y as a function of x. So let's see how this performs. Now, you can see that the qualitative difference between the predictions of the model compared to those from the model that considered only aleatoric uncertainty. This model predicts more variability as x gets more negative, in addition to getting more positive, something that is not possible to do with a simple linear model. Now, so far we've been assuming that the data follows a line. What if this is not true? What if we don't know the functional relationship between the inputs and the labels? Suppose we have a vague sense that the predicted labels should be familiar to the labels already seen only if the corresponding inputs are close to what we already observed. In other words, the only assumption we wish to make is that the function we are fitting to the data is smooth. And what it means is that a smooth function is a function that has derivatives of all orders everywhere in the domain. The standard tool for doing such regression while making these sort of assumptions is the Gaussian process. And it's a very powerful model which uses a kernel function to encode this smoothness assumption between the inputs and labels should take. And we'll condition this on the data. It forms a probability distribution over functions that are consistent with those assumptions and the data. TFP provides this as a variational Gaussian process layer, which uses a variational approximation to a full Gaussian process for an efficient yet flexible regression model. For simplicity, we'll be considering only the epistemic uncertainty about the form of the relationship between inputs and labels. And in terms of the assumptions we'll be making, we'll simply assume that the function we are fitting is locally smooth. It can vary as much as it wants across the entire data set. But if two inputs are close, it'll return similar values. As you can see, due to the power of this model, it is much more complex. We need to define a loss function, and there are more parameters to specify. But this added complexity is really worth it. The variational Gaussian process has discovered a periodic structure in the data. Did you notice it before? This structure was present in the data throughout. Importantly, the model discovered this structure without telling us that there is any such periodicity in the data. For example, close to zero, the periodic structure is not as apparent, so the model does not commit to any such relationship in that region. Now, how do we introduce uncertainty as a bottleneck? Let's try to build a variational autoencoder using TFP layers. Variational autoencoders are popular generative models, as you might know, and they can be used in different domains, such as collaborative filtering, image compression, reinforcement learning, and generation of music and sketches. Their latent spaces are, by design, continuous, which allows easy random sampling and interpolation. We can parameterize a probability distribution with the output of a very deep neural network. This is the basic structure of a VAE. The encoder takes the inputs and tries to come up with a compressed low-dimensional representation. Then the decoder tries to reconstruct this representation back to the input. And we use KL divergence to see the reconstruction loss. Now, variational autoencoders make strong assumptions concerning the distribution of latent variables. They use a variational approach for latent representation learning, which results in additional loss component. Now let's try to generate mnist digits in our head. So it'll basically have two steps. You sample some latent representation Z from prior distribution, and you see this, if you imagine in your head, this will be a fuzzy picture. So let's say you imagine 5. Now, based on your sample, you draw the actual picture representation, and you model itself as a stochastic process. Now, this captures the data that each time you write a 5, it looks a little different. Thus, when a handwritten digit is created, we imagine some of the variation is due to some kind of signal inherent to the process, such as the class identity of the MNIST digit. And some of that variation is due to noise, such as difference in the precise angles of the lines among different samples in the digit. Broadly, a VAE is an attempt to try to separate the signal from the noise. And to train this objective, we will maximize the elbow objective, which is the evidence lower bound. To train this objective, we maximize the elbow, where the three probability density functions are P of Z, which is the prior on the latent representation Z, PZ given X, which is the variation autoencoder, PX given Z, which is the decoder. How likely is the image X given the representation Z? The elbow is a lower bound on log P of X, the log probability of an observed data point. The first integral in the elbow bound on log P of X is the log probability of an observed data point. The first integral in the elbow method in the equation is the reconstruction term, which you can see is basically how likely we are to start at an image X, encoded to Z, and decoded back to the original X. The second term is our KL divergence term. It is a measure of how one probability distribution is different from a second. That is to say, it measures how closely together our encoder and prior are. If our encoder generates Z samples that are too unlikely given our prior, the objective is worse than if it generates Z samples more typical to the prior. Thus, the encoder should differ from the prior only if the cost of doing so is outweighed by the benefit in the reconstruction term. So to model this, for our encoder distribution, we will use a full covariance Gaussian distribution with its mean and covariance matrices parameterized by the output of a neural network. Now, this may sound complicated, but it's much easier when you try to express it with TFP layers. The encoder is just normal Keras sequential layers consisting of convolutions and dense layers. Activations from the final dense layers into the paths needed to specify both the mean and the covariance matrix. And we use a helper function, which is the tfpl.multivariate normal TRIL parameter size to make the dense layer output the correct number of activations. Finally, we said that the distribution should contribute a regularization term to the final loss. Specifically, we are adding the KL divergence between the encoder and prior to the loss, which is the KL term is the elbow that we have just described. And for a decoder, we will use a simple mean field decoder, and it is independent Bernoulli distribution. And it actually looks quite similar to the encoder, but we are using transpose convolutions to take our latent representation, which is a 16-dimensional vector, and turn it into a 28x28x1 tensor. That final tensor parameterizes the pixel-independent Bernoulli distribution. Now we are ready to build the full model and specify the rest of the loss functions. Our model is essentially a Keras model where the outputs are defined as the composition of the encoder and the decoder. Since the encoder already has that added KL term to the loss, we need to specify only the reconstruction loss. This loss function takes two arguments, the original input X and the output of the model. Now, we can call RVX because it is a random variable. And this example demonstrates some of the core magic of TFP layers. And we can also make a loss function to be the negative log likelihood of the data given the model. Now, is it worth taking a moment to understand what TFP layers is actually doing to integrate transparency with Keras? But if a TFP layer returns distributions, what happens to it when you compose the decoder with the output of the encoder? Actually, in Keras, to view the encoder distribution as a tensor, TFP layers actually relies on something called as a distribution as a sample from the distribution, which is just a fancy way of saying that Keras sees the distribution object as a tensor Now, training that model is very easy, just like you train a normal Keras model. You just need to call fit, and it will train it. And now you can see that we have generated some MNIST digits using a variation autoencoder. Now, Blaise Cronin is an Irish-American information scientist, and he said something particularly interesting. He said that probabilistic programming will unlock narrative explanations of data, one of the holy grails of business analytics and the unsung hero of scientific persuasion. People think in terms of stories, thus the unreasonable power of the anecdote to drive decision-making, well-founded or not. But existing analytics largely fails to provide this kind of a story. Instead, numbers seemingly appear out of thin air, and it is little to do with the casual context that humans prefer when weighing their options. So as you can see how important it is to take into account uncertainty. And I hope that you will use not only TensorFlow probability, but also other languages inside that, like Edward 2, which is completely probabilistic. It's a completely probabilistic programming language. Thank you.
So thank you for Niladri's talk. Look at Sido, there's no question. Does anybody here have any question you want to ask directly? You can turn on the microphone in front of you if you have any. Nope. Okay. So next slide will be the refreshment and the job fair. So let's give Niladri another applause again.
Thank you for having me here and have a great PyCon.
Yeah, and I will bring him outside if you have any question, just come here.